Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you what we can expect from SpaceX's Starship serial number 8, how it's built, and what comes after it.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. SpaceX is getting ready for the final stint of 2020 in Boca Chica, Texas. If everything goes as planned, there are a few very important milestones still to be achieved before we can celebrate New Year's Eve. Development at the South Texas spaceport is reaching mind-boggling speeds, and today we're, as always, looking at the latest progress made since the last episode. Let's start this episode off with one of my favorites. My friend Mauricio from RGV Aerial Photography was in the air again doing one of his breathtaking aerial photoshoots. The bird's eye view by far is the best way to see the latest progress and at the same time get a feeling for what's where and what the true scale of the project is by now. SpaceX right now is building their own little Kennedy Space Center with one big difference. This is where the future of spaceflight is shaped right now, and SpaceX is letting us watch it, which, by the way, cannot be taken for granted. So take a moment and appreciate SpaceX's openness to their research and development here and the awesome pictures brought to you by Mauricio from RGV Aerial Photography, Mary from NASA Spaceflight, Lewis from Lab Padre, and Jean and Rachel from South Padre. All other launch providers develop behind closed doors, even though their tech mostly is already known. One possible reason for SpaceX's approach of letting the world watch might be that their lead is so big it would right now almost be impossible for others to build something similar. There are a few out there trying to rebuild Falcon 9 technology, but for SpaceX, that's already a chapter about to be closed. Mauricio's pictures are from September 24th. Here, Starship Serial number 8 is still sitting in front of the midbay, waiting to be rolled out to the launch site. A lot of work was still in progress on top of the dome. On September 26th, Starship Serial number 8, the latest iteration of SpaceX's prototype design process, got rolled out to the launch site in preparation for cryogenic testing, hopefully today on September 29th. These rollouts are always a great opportunity for locals to get as close as possible and take some very interesting pictures standing right next to the passing Starship. Jean and Rachel from South Padre took the opportunity and provided us all with some absolutely awesome detailed shots. Let me give you a quick rundown on what we can see here and what's new on Serial number 8. So, first of all, there are no visible COPVs on the outside of Serial number 8. COPV stands for Composite Pressure Vessel. Randy from Spaceship Mania sent me an awesome model of Starship Serial number 5 as a present for my 100K celebration. COPVs are those black tanks, so far found on every Starship prototype, sitting on the outside of the hull. If you're interested, a link to this and other models from Spaceship Mania is in the description. Thank you, Randy, you rock. The COPVs provide compressed gas to all sorts of systems. Thrust vector control of the engines and reaction control thrusters to be able to steer the Starship in flight and Raptor engine turbopump spin-up are the most important processes to utilize gas from the COPVs. The obvious reason for the COPVs now being somewhere else is that the location on the outside of the hull was just temporary. On the finished design, they cannot be on the outside anyway, as it wouldn't be very aerodynamic and they'd need shielding to not be ripped off or burned on re-entry. Since Starship Serial number 8 is the first prototype to fly higher than just 150 meters up, it also is the first design to have to mount the COPVs in a different place. There are a few possible places where SpaceX could mount these COPVs besides the outside of the hull, inside the aerodynamic covers. These are the blends covering the hinges and actuators for the aft flaps. There should at least be some room in there. Another possible place would be the forward dome. We can almost rule this location out though by just looking at one of Mauricio's shots from right before the rollout. There are no COPVs visible here. A third option would be the nose cone. One problem SpaceX faced while designing the Starship was, and likely still is, center of mass. Corey from Seabest3D did an awesome animation a few weeks ago showing a Starship Serial number 8 flight to a height of 20 kilometers. It also shows the transition into the skydive maneuver at the apogee and the transition back out of it just before landing. To achieve this transition between vertical and horizontal flight, the center of mass should ideally be right in the middle of the Starship. This way, the swing takes much less effort from the flaps and engines, saving energy and making the whole process much more reliable. SpaceX, for example, got rid of the three-fin design for this very reason and changed it to two aft flaps. Starships are tail-heavy as the engines and aft flaps shift the center of mass quite a bit down. The logical countermeasure from the engineering standpoint is to move as much hardware into the nose tip as possible. For this, SpaceX has already moved one of the header tanks needed to store landing fuel from the main tanks into the very tip of the nose. Tanks can rather easily be moved around, and so one of the possible places where SpaceX could move the COPVs would definitely be the nose cone. If you look at South Padre's pictures again, we can see lots of small silver-looking pipes go all the way from the top down to the engine skirt. Those are lines normally connected to COPVs. Since there are no COPVs sitting on top of the forward dome though, my guess is that these lines will be continued upwards inside the nose cone towards the COPVs. We can also see orange cables going down from the top. Those most likely are power lines coming from the Tesla battery on top of the forward dome. In fact, the battery pack can easily be spotted on Mauricio's aerial shot, and orange cables attached to it can be seen too. The power lines run down on the outside of the hull and then disappear into the engine skirt. Silver heat protection wrapping has been added to make them withstand the increased heat close to the Raptor engine. On the inside, they are running along the engine skirt towards the plate motors, a high-powered variant of Tesla car motors, which then are connected to a gearbox moving the flaps. So SpaceX already got rid of the old system where the Tesla motors were not directly connected and instead were used for a hydraulic system, which in return moved the flaps. A third very obvious component of the outside plumbing on Starship Serial No. 8 are two large tubes running alongside the hull. These tubes appear on the engine skirt and go up. One enters the hull at the top of the oxygen tank and the other one all the way up on top of the methane tank. Those are the famous autogenous pressurization lines, feeding gas from the engine turbopumps back up into the main tanks to keep them pressurized in flight. This way, SpaceX can get rid of the helium system needed on Falcon rockets, for example, for repressurization. And we also have a few more data cables for controls and sensors connected to the avionics system on top of the forward dome. On the other side of the Starship, there is not much to see besides two manholes. Those are the hatches SpaceX builds into the current Starship prototypes to give workers access to the inside of the hull after stacking. There's always work left to be done inside the tanks, like connecting fuel lines, checking the structure, or welding. All Starships had them. Even Starhopper used the same system. When SpaceX sealed them on Starship Serial No. 8, though, something strange became visible. There's a bullseye painted onto both hatches, and in the middle it even says SpaceX. One possible reason for this could be tracking purposes. A quick look at Astronomy Films, which by the way is a channel I definitely recommend if you're interested in beautifully done shorts of historical missions, reveals that tracking marks on rockets are nothing new. NASA, for example, used them extensively on their early rockets. Saturn V's black and white checkerboard lines, for example, had a similar purpose. There's no official information yet on why SpaceX put these bull's eyes on the hatches. What are your thoughts? As always, tell me in the comments. Liked the update so far? Then click the like button, subscribe to the channel, and maybe even consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Link is in the description. The team is working relentlessly to provide you with updates twice a week, thanks to SpaceX's mind-boggling speed, and with your support it will be much easier in the future. Thank you. SpaceX is getting ready for higher flights on all fronts. Prototypes are getting more and more advanced, infrastructure is being fleshed out everywhere in Boca Chica, and Elon Musk has given us a lot of information via Twitter in the last few days. He tweeted a picture of Serial No. 8 just before the rollout and started handing out bits and pieces of very interesting information. Nose cone and front flaps, for example, will now be installed in the coming week. This gives SpaceX enough time to perform the already announced cryo testing of Serial No. 8 on September 29th, the 30th, and on October 1st. He also said that the first flight of Starship Serial No. 8 will be to a height of 15 kilometers, or roughly 50,000 feet. No small 150-meter hop first. Elaborating on future plans, he added that this phase of medium-height hops to a maximum of 20 kilometers won't last long either. SpaceX needs a way to confirm that body flaps and header tanks work properly. Several flights will be performed in this configuration. A Starship with nose cone and all flaps able to reach a height of 20 kilometers. After this, SpaceX will add a heat shield and go high Mach. Those will likely still not be orbital flights, but they will be significantly higher. We're talking above 100 kilometers. He did not give a time frame, but looking at SpaceX's speed right now, we can most likely expect several flights in October and November, and then maybe, just maybe, a first flight above the edge of space either in December or early next year. Musk also lifted a few mysteries about the recent serial number 7.1 test tank and its results. It was mostly made of 304L stainless steel with some 301 left in the construction. It broke at the interface between 301 and 304L. SpaceX is already putting the test data to good use and is further tweaking the alloy mixture in the future. According to his tweet, serial number 8 reached 8 bar differential in ullage and 9 bar at the base due to propellant head. This means that a pressure of 8 bar was reached at the top and that the base of the tank had to endure 9 bar due to the added weight of the propellant pressing down on the aft dome. His verdict? It's enough, and future improvements are in the works right now. To put Musk's statement into perspective, he previously stated that Starships need around 6 bar of pressure for flights and that around 8.5 bar is needed to have enough safety margin for crewed flights. So even though Test Tank 7.1 wasn't the end of development on the alloy and construction side, it's already well beyond flight worthy and almost at the point of being safe enough for human spaceflight. And all that while building it in tents with stainless steel. The next weeks are going to be the most exciting ones yet. If everything goes well, Starship serial number 8 will take flight. A fully built prototype, including a nose cone and all the flaps. It will do so to test absolutely vital systems. The concepts of flaps and header tanks will need to prove their worthiness. We will see serial number 8 skydive down towards the landing site, swing around and hopefully land. After that, stakes will be raised on the first high Mach flights, including re-entry. Is SpaceX about to show the world that Starships are the future? If you want to show the world that you're a fan of What About It, check out my merch store, support the channel, and dress differently. It's full of designs and all sorts of products made by me and my awesome team to fill your closets and drawers with awesome shirts, hoodies, zippers, jackets, base caps, cups, bags, you get the idea. Today we also opened our European store, so shipping times and costs for the EU are basically halved from now on. On top of that, everything on the store right now is 15% off for a limited time, and my 100k milestone design is still available as well until the end of October due to high demand. Grab it while it's still there. Every sale supports the channel. Today's Patreon and YouTube member shoutout goes to Debin Ray, Terry McEwen, Gary Saldana, Eric Kestner, David Wheeler, and many others. You rock. Thank you all so much for your support. Without your help, What About It would look very different. If you want to be part of the community, chat with me and the others in person on our voice channels, or if you want to be part of the team, consider becoming a Patreon or YouTube member yourself. A link to my Patreon page can be found in the description. My last words, as always, are for my awesome team, and today's honorable mention goes to Hasey and Ryan OC for relentlessly working on our new website right now. It's a mammoth project, as our ideas are ambitious and seeing it take shape right now is incredible. Thank you very much for your help. You rock. Development at the South Texas From the engineering standpoint is to move We're talking above 100,000 kilometers. No, we're not.